reach the lost graveyard of ships, Merin would have to cross the foul and treacherous region known as Watcher's Hollow. This was a place her father had never sung about, for the tales of the Watcher were known only to those below. Cuttlepops swam through the dark caverns, heedless of their deadly surroundings. Maybe they were tougher than they looked. Even the stinging anemones seemed to avoid them.
Thank you.
Merin sailed out into a great, open expanse of water. The howls of hungry leviathans echoed in the distance. This seemingly bottomless trench was known as the Maw. Hard-headed Nautiloceros watched Merin from a distance, waiting for an opportunity to strike. Merin found another fragment of a Fomori sentinel. Each new piece would help her further strengthen her own vessel. Recovering from a bad dream. For a moment, she thought she had experienced her own death, but it had merely been the Tyne showing her one of the many possible roads ahead.
Thank you.
Merrin spotted a tall, sleek tower. It looked somehow familiar, but she couldn't remember where she had seen it before. An old diving bell sat amongst the rocks. The Fomori had once used them to navigate the maze of deep undersea currents. Merrin wondered, if her father had come this way, could he have used one of the diving bells? Across miles and miles of sunken ships. She had entered Skeleton Reef. How many ships lay here? Hundreds. Maybe thousands. The very thought gave her chills, but she knew that somewhere amidst the broken wrecks she would find her father's boat. Shuddered as she thought of the men and women who had once walked through the rooms of this giant ship. Shuddered as she thought of the men and women who had once walked through the rooms of this giant ship. Froze as she saw a Fomori sentinel ahead of her. Of all their creations, the sentinels were the ones Merin feared the most. There were once thousands of these unmanned vessels, patrolling every inch of the sea. They collected what was valuable to the Fomori and destroyed what was not. And so they might continue, following their sleepless patrols, until everything under the sea is silent and still. Sentinel shook from the blast of the mine. Its hull had been weakened. Pieces of the Fomori Sentinel drift down toward the sea floor. She knew it had very nearly been her down there instead.
Thank you.
broken bits of wood below her was still untarnished by seawater. And the paint on them matched that of her father's boat. But if they were pieces of his boat, where was the rest of it? And where was he? As she entered the vortex, Merrin felt herself spinning around. She braced herself against the sides of the sob. But when it finally stopped spinning, she had emerged in a different part of the world.
Thank you.
dove back down into the twisting passages of Watcher's Hollow, thinking her father might be trapped further below. But with every passing second, she felt the chill of unseen eyes watching her and waiting to strike. A fisherman's glove was caught on a jagged piece of rock. Wrapped around it was a deflated strand of glow kelp. Could that be her father's glove? He had taught her that glow kelp bulbs could be used to breathe for a short while. As Merin entered the Watcher's lair, she saw a wriggling cocoon stuck to the wall. Her heart raced. Could that be her father?
Thank you.
returned to the cocoon, frantic, her heart sank. It wasn't her father inside. Just a funny-looking little sea serpent. A baby leviathan. The little serpent swam around in circles, waving its tail as if to say, "Thank you." Merrin tried to shoo it away, back to wherever it lived. But the odd little creature just followed her. The young serpent wanted to play. It swam back and forth, swishing its tail, trying to get Merrin's attention. Perhaps, she thought, doesn't hurt to have just one friend in the lonely depths of the sea. Swish. She would call him Swish. Swish dove down, playfully rummaging around the debris that lay below. Merrin was about to call him back when she saw that he had found something. Merrin looked over the curious contraption that Swish had found, trying to guess at its purpose. After a little work, she discovered a way to use it for channeling and projecting time energy. Giant clams were notoriously picky eaters. Each one seemed to prefer a different kind of treat. Thank you. swish had led Merrin back to Cara's home in the Merrow ruins, but the doors were sealed shut. Hoping to speak with her, Merrin searched for another way in. Led into the bottom of the house, but the submarine was too big to fit through. Once been a flourishing city. What had happened here? Where were all the Merrows now? Scanned the quiet waters of the ruins, a solemn reminder of an ancient conflict. Merrin had discovered an old diving suit. She put it on, and in a pocket of the suit she found a striped seashell tied to a string. It looked just like the one her father kept above the fireplace. She tied the string around her neck, hoping the shell would bring her luck. Merrin held her breath and dove out through the submarine's hatch. She noticed bubbles coming out of the shell around her neck. Putting it to her mouth, she gently breathed in and felt the air fill her cheeks. Were these the same shells that were once used by ancient explorers?